This is the story of the struggles and dreams of four men as they strive for Olympic gold, an intimate record of their personal lives, loves, ambitions and fears on the long road to Sydney. Redgrave is the most successful and famous of the four. He's won four Olympic golds, the last two in a coxless pair with old Etonian Matthew Pinsent, who he teamed up with in 1990. But at the last Olympics, he decided to retire at the age of 34.
If anyone sees me go anywhere near a boat, you've got my permission to shoot me. I do not ever want to get in a boat again. I've had enough.
But once again, the lure of gold proved too strong. In 1997, Steve and Matthew formed a new coxless four-boat with Tim Foster and James Cracknell. They began recording personal video diaries, knowing the next 4 years were not going to be easy for any of them.
Just getting so fed up with it. Is it worth it? Is Olympic Games worth going through this hassle?
Basically, we need to pull the rabbit out of the hat. If we're going to win, we need to pull a very sizable rabbit out of a very small hat. I think the odds of doing that are pretty slim, actually, I have to say now.
The four have to bond if they are to succeed. No one's seat is guaranteed, but newcomers Tim and James are the most vulnerable. James Cracknell is the youngest at 25 and has never won a major race.
Everybody who rows in Britain really wants to be in the four. And I can't see that changing over the next 4 years, really. So, you know, Matthew's got two gold medals and he rows on the same side as me, so... basically everyone's after my seat. Well, half the people after my seat, half the people after Tim's seat.
Tim Foster, who is 27, has a bronze Olympic medal and seems more relaxed. But even he is in no doubt about the reality of the situation.
Three and a bit, yes. Till Sydney, which is a big one, but we very definitely feel we've got to win every race, which is a different mentality. Not really being in that situation before. I mean, to win was always nice, but it's almost like we're frightened to lose in this one.
We have plenty of time.
Jurgen Grobler is charged with bringing the four together. Former East German Olympic coach, his priority is now the coxless four, Britain's best hope for an Olympic gold.
And be still positive to the work we are doing and switched on to the work we are doing, even as hard and hurts, you know.
The weight of expectation falls heavily on Steve's shoulders. If he gets his fifth gold, he will make Olympic history. So it's crucial that the team comes together.
It seems like, to me, it seems like you've gone off on your own to do your own thing. But we're trying to bring us together as a unit on and off the water.
Okay, I mean, I only did it. It was basically what, that's the way I interpreted what Jurgen said.
I think James can get sometimes carried away with the intensity of it all. It doesn't matter what he's done. It's not good enough. And I think because... maybe that you haven't had success in the last few years, that your enthusiasm sometimes boils over and becomes slightly too intense.
The first real test of how the boat is running will be the 1997 World Championships in France. They gear themselves totally to this, fine-tuning every tiny detail. And then suddenly the world goes into a state of shock. Princess Diana has died, and the four are faced with representing Britain at a time of national mourning.
it's sort of hitting us a bit actually now how big a deal it is at home, because I've seen some of the press articles. We're so separated from out here and so focused on what we plan to do for the whole year that it really doesn't mean anything to us, because it just doesn't work because we're just so separated from it.
So what do you reckon till tomorrow then?
We could win by clear water. We could win by a length and a half.
Depends on what the other crews have decided, really.
If anyone comes with us, they're going to pay for it.
Yeah.
It's the same situation as we were in the pair for a long time.
Yeah.
Was that if people were going to chase us down, they were going to pay. Well, I was really quite nervous during today.
I've had moments, and it comes and goes.
Is James going to be shitting himself tomorrow?
I don't know. It'll be quiet and... I won't mind if he is. I mean, I don't think there's anything wrong with being nervous. I don't imagine him getting too nervous.
Mm. I'm looking forward to it, but I'm more looking forward to being halfway through the race than the hour or 2 hours beforehand, which is just a nightmare. You don't feel like eating. We update 2 hours before, we don't feel like eating. You feel just sitting there with the walkman on, just getting ready to go. Trying to stop the, you know, be too aroused, make you too tense, it's all... It's going to be... a tough day tomorrow.
James gives his video camera to his Danish girlfriend Emily, while he goes off to compete in the biggest race of his career.
This is it, the first final day at the World Championships in France, and today is a big race that everyone has been waiting for.
You must be totally full of butterflies in your stomach. Good luck!
Great Britain lead from lane 3. James Cracknell behind is doing a sterling job. Never won a medal of any colour, World Championships or Olympic Games. This could be his day.
Get in a competitive situation, you really get the best out of Matthew then. He's really impressive when he chips it down. And you know, Steve, so strong, so dynamic. And Tim sets up the rhythm really well between Steve and Matthew. I was sitting there with my bus ticket.
Buster there between Pinsent and Redgrave. He's had quite a lot of experience in coxless fours. He's had bronze and silver at World Championships, bronze in the Olympics at Atlanta.
Just all about setting down the standard there. They're looking back and saying, well, look, you know, you're not going to get near us today.
Oh, this is brilliant. Totally in the lead.
Great Britain take the gold. Cracknell and Foster side by side, equal partners with Redgrave and Pinsent. That is as it should be.
What a great row in the final. What a great row. Just everyone all hooked up together and just flowing along. Just felt easy. Brilliant.
As a mark of respect, we wore our black bows and the flag only went to half mast, and we had our heads bowed during the national anthem, and that made an impact on people, and I think we did absolutely the right thing. This means that I'm a world champion. And it feels pretty damn good, I have to say. The morning was so difficult with the pressure and the nerves and everything else, and then we just went out and had an absolute stormer of a row.
We just shattered the Olympic sort of medalist by 2 lengths, which is just wicked. But I'll go back to how secure my position feels. I mean, on a row like that, feels pretty fucking secure at the moment.
This is why I row. This is why I do it. Just for feelings like this, and it's not a feeling that will go away either. It won't go away. It'll be still there tomorrow. It'll still be there next week. Oh. We're a quarter of the way to the Sydney Olympics, and that portion of the road is now covered in gold.
The four do most of their British training at the elite Leander Club in Henley. Their new season is about to start when Steve tells his video diary potentially devastating news.
Yesterday, I started having a tremendous thirst, feeling very dehydrated. Been away for a couple of weeks, been away to the Bahamas for a couple of weeks, on holiday with my wife, and I've been a bit ill while I've been away, but not too bad. And suddenly it dawned on me yesterday late afternoon that I've been through this situation before, and when I've been in this situation before, that I'd come down with diabetes.
When Steve had diabetes before, it didn't last. He's not so lucky this time. The doctors say it's permanent.
What I thought was, has happened, that that I'm diabetic, have to take insulin. They feel pretty confident that I'll be able to carry on the sport, but they also say how difficult it's going to be. These are the syringes now. I'd rather it hadn't happened. But all you can do is live with it and get on with it. Cope with it. Not a good start to the season. Day back, and I'm half an hour late already, and still got to get to Henley. James is at the club first, then Matthew. Tim and I are normally a bit late.
Tim lives the furthest away in the Oxford University boathouse and is often late.
So the camera's not very steady this morning. 7:20, or there or thereabouts. Hello. And it's amazing what you pick up in the boathouse. Yes. As anyone says, you look very attractive in oversized rain kit.
No, not yet.
Funny that. And there's always Luca, the pimp. There we go, we're in a rush, aren't we? I've remembered.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Oh. What do you think of the hair? Nice, eh, this morning? Good day for a silly hat.
Test my blood sugar levels before we get there. Try and save a bit of time on arrival.
Steve, stop bleating, but if anybody can cope with it, he probably can. In terms of, knows exactly what he's got to do for international rowing. It's just a bit more of a challenge for him now. He's got to cope with diabetes, but if other people can cope with it, I'm sure he can.
Morning.
Good morning.
Afternoon.
The four are professional athletes. Sponsorship and lottery money fund them to train full time.
Timbo just arrived.
I'll wait for him.
Had a bit of trouble getting out of bed this morning.
Yeah. Rubbish.
I did.
Oh, sunshine. Didn't think there was going to be any of this morning.
During the winter, the boys spend a lot of the time training in singles and pairs. The only race as a four is a local event called the Four's Head, but Steve doesn't want to go in for it, as he explains to Jurgen.
At this stage, I feel that I should be getting myself
sorted it out and getting out of getting my blood sugar levels right and knowing what training I can do and just concentrate on my single for this period. I don't really want to be put under the pressure of thinking, all right, I've got to be fit for this quad or I've got to be fit for the four.
It's pointless to rush Steve when he's deciding he's got to sort out his levels of how much insulin he needs to take and how much glucose so he can sort of do the training. It doesn't really mean, doesn't affect me that much in that if we give him time to sort it out, I don't think he'll have any. Obviously, it's better not to have it, but I don't think it'll have any dramatic difference on his training. It's alright. Won't be a problem.
James has other things on his mind. His girlfriend Emily has come from Denmark to live with him.
Onion and garlic.
It's a big step, as they've only seen each other 20 times in the past year.
Does it smell good? It's not,
not bad.
Far from finished. Like, it's far from finished. Oops! Hi!
There's no meat
right now.
Bung some tuna in it.
No, James, how could you do that?
Why can't you bung tuna in it?
Because it's not for tuna.
How do you know? Well, what does it make any difference? It's a sauce, isn't it?
It'll just be different, though.
But you can certainly onions and aubergine and stuff. But you could put tuna in it. I eat tuna with everything.
This is definitely not tuna.
I don't really know what it's like living in one because I never lived in one before. But, as in someone you have a relationship with. So it seems to be okay, but a few arguments every now and then. But not too bad. Especially as I'm pretty moody and she's pretty stroppy, so it's.
Can you put my baby?
Steve, 10 years older, has a more settled domestic relationship. He's married to Anne, a doctor, and they have two daughters, Natalie and Sophie.
So just to turn the video off, Daddy.
What?
Because she's going to have a little paddy.
Well, this is what life's about.
You didn't have it on when you had your paddy the other day, did you, Dad?
Right, Soph. What's Mummy got in her tummy?
Baby.
When's it coming?
At my birthday time.
When's your birthday?
February.
February the what?
19th.
The 19th. Sophie says she's going to call it Lucy.
And if it's a boy?
She's still going to call it Lucy.
During the next 3 months, Steve drops out of all public competition in an effort to control his diabetes. Jurgen has given him until April to be worthy of his place. He's training alongside the other three, but it's very much a personal battle.
Just about managing to do the training. Get pretty tired. From the success you've had over the years that you get a little bit of leeway, but I don't think that leeway should be very much. You have to be in a unit because of what you can do, not what you've done. I've got to prove to myself, not really to the others, but to myself that I'm still good enough and I'm going to be good enough to justify my slot within the four. And I suppose within the pair with Matthew for April trials, which is supposed to be the plan. And if I'm not justifying that to myself and also to the others, then I'll be looking for something else to do.
While Steve faces failure for the first time in his career, the others are enjoying the satisfaction of a successful autumn's training.
Me, it's been a good sort of 3 months, October, November, December. Tests have shown I'm the fittest I've ever been at this time of year. Yeah, it's more of the same. I mean, Jurgen's comment the other day was that what Steve has lost in this break has been more than made up by James and myself coming on. I know Matthew's worried about Steve, not as much in terms of illness, but in terms of how often he's turned up. We haven't seen Steve for nearly 2 weeks now, I think. Went away to Lapland with the kids. Didn't come down between the break and has now gone off skiing for Christmas for 2 weeks. So, yeah, I mean, it's not ideal. But, I mean, I think in his position, I'd wait for the results of all these tests. I'd get them over and done with and come back in the new year. So a new year, new start. Hopefully, right as rain.
Steve needs to get away from everything. A week before Christmas, he is told he has developed colitis. It seems like one thing after another. He decides to spend Christmas in France with his family.
He comes down. Not bad that somebody's going to give birth in 6 weeks' time. Venturing out onto the slopes. Quite impressive.
I think half the fun with Christmas as you get older is seeing the fun and the excitement that the kids get out of it. Bringing back your own youth.
Where do you keep in?
Yeah, because it's 7 o'clock. It comes at 2 o'clock.
Right, we're going to have a look downstairs and see if we can fit.
Sally!
No, that's Susie.
Susie, I got Susie.
Wow.
Yeah, so now I've got Julie, Shelley, and Susie.
James spends Christmas in Denmark with Emily's family.
So we've had a few beers, a bit of dinner. It's now 10 o'clock, and now you open your presents, and then you go to church. So I haven't been to church for 2-3 years, so it's going to be a bit strange. Then you come back and have some more beers at midnight, or no, 1 o'clock, and then I don't really know what you do tomorrow. Have some more beers, I imagine. Seems pretty much like it.
Tim and Matthew go to their parents for some home comforts.
I love coming down here for Christmas. Well, I love coming down here at any time of the year, actually. Because it's so far away from rowing.
It's Christmas 1997, and I like it.
New Year opens with a round of tests and competitive pairs training. Not having seen Steve for so long, the others don't know what to expect.
Even if he wasn't ill, having missed the training he'd missed, he'd be unfit. And he hasn't really admitted that to himself, I think. One of the papers said we were pulling him along for now. Which isn't true in terms of his dead weight or whatever, but I mean, there's got to be an element if we can pull him in to the group and he can use us a bit. Maybe that'll help. Sort of help all of us, really. I mean, can't row a pair, can't row a four or two pairs with only three people.
The world's best rower for 14 years, Steve is not giving up without a fight. He's refreshed from his Christmas break and throws himself into training.
Right then, big boy. Right then.
Just before the four go off together on a training camp to South Africa, they are pushed to the limits with tests on the ergo machines, a test they all dread. Steve now feels confident enough to join in.
I've had two very good weeks. Done some decent training. And at a reasonable level, a level that you could call an international a men's athlete. So things have been looking a bit brighter. You don't realise of how low and depressed and how hard, now ill, that I really felt without really realising
it. I done it.
Good girl. I think you start going better. Because things are starting to go better now, I realise of having a little bit more energy. He says, yawning. On the baby front, I can see it coming in the next 2.5 weeks while I'm away. We're hoping that that she can hang on to it until I return. That's still 10 days before the due date. But who knows? Who knows of when a baby's going to arrive? So it's in the lap of the gods.
The African camp is one of many leading up to the Olympics. The idea is that the four will benefit from intensive training abroad, away from the distractions of friends and family.
How'd it be going?
Soon.
What's the time?
Quarter to five.
I thought we had to leave at four.
Something like that.
Oh my word.
What are these girls up with sunglasses?
Can you give us a ring?
Yeah. It's difficult leaving family behind at this time. Trying to get the kids to behave, they normally play up when I go away. And with Anne being pregnant, it's pretty tough on her.
So.
Kiss, kiss.
You're going away?
See ya.
I need to be doing this camp. It's not just from the training point of view, because the performance is starting to come back. I need to be showing the others that it's coming back, so I had to make a showing. Push on. Drive further forward. We will make it.
Oh shit.
Yeah.
Oh shit.
The van won't drive further forward. It can't quite handle dragging the big boys and their equipment up the hills. Jurgen's a great fan of high altitude camps, but they do present their difficulties.
We never have this problem in Henley.
Hang on.
It's not sounding very well. It's sounding like it's got a few cylinders missing somewhere.
Wow, sick and heavy. That was the heaviest car in the camp, in the bloody camper.
No, it's not going to do it.
Some Barry White?
Whatever you want.
Training with the other boys makes it easier for Steve. They spur each other on. They are fiercely competitive.
Is it appearing yet?
Been dreading it ever since I knew we were coming out here. Meeant heights don't really mix very well. I never thought I'd do that.
But for Steve, competition isn't all gain, especially when trying to cope with diabetes.
It's gone so well against the others. I thought, right, this is it, I've really turned the corner, really going for it now. And then, poof.
After the last 3 good weeks of training, I've had a bad session. And that's depressed me. Still pleased the way it's gone. But the ergo is the worst time to do it. Because it's right in front of everybody. Everyone can see you. And you just feel such an ass.
Steve and Matthew, they're very competitive, you know they're not going to let you beat them easily. And, I want to beat them all the time. If me beating them means that it makes them train harder to try and beat me, then that's going to be good for our four.
Just feel like I've got to prove myself all the time. It's not a bad thing. I think who I'm proving myself to is to myself. Because in the end, that's the person that matters. I can do it. I will do it. No question. Alright, that's enough of depression. Let's get on with it. Give yourself 18 units of insulin.
We've forgotten the 10mm spanner, which is the nut size on like all boats, so we can't take any of the riggers off.
We've all got our own 10mm spanners back at the
flats. We're such sad rowing geeks, we take them with us everywhere.
Mm. But obviously coaches don't. despite having a tall bag this large, he hasn't got the one useful spanner.
No, it's not a 10mm. It would be good. It's not a 10mm, it's a 9mm or something like that.
Hang on, now it's screwed, look. It's got little screws.
It's moving!
It's time to turn green.
Start ripping your top.
I've got it.
No, I can't do it.
South Africa proves to be the turning point for Steve. Much to everyone's relief, he's back to form and his place in the four is looking more secure. With his newfound confidence, Steve decides to leave the camp early. He doesn't want to risk missing his baby's birth.
Right. Safe trip?
Yeah, cheers, Tim.
It's difficult for all of them to get the balance right between rowing and relationships.
So with Steve going, James has been James trying to work out if Em's pregnant as well, in terms of could that be his excuse to go home. I think he really wants to go home. He's not exactly had enough, but with James it's fairly easy to tell when he's either bored or frustrated.
It's the first year I've been in a relationship sort of this serious, I suppose. It's the best way to say it. So yeah, it is different, especially when I live with them. It's not really nice going away for this long, especially though I just really like him as well.
And I found in relationships before, it's definitely caused tension because it's like if it becomes a competition between them or rowing, then rowing wins. And that's the way it's always been for me, I think. First and foremost, I'm a rower, I guess. I mean, I hope it's not all my life, but it's the biggest part of my life.
And we're away for Valentine's Day as well.
Monday the 16th. It's 5:45 in the morning. And it's time to go to the hospital to the birth of the new baby.
Oh, okay, see you soon. Bye-bye.
And contractions now about 5 minutes apart. Thought it would be sort of early hours in the morning, so not a very good night's sleep. But at least it's going to happen now. So off to the hospital.
Yeah, Mum.
It's a boy, and they decide not to call him Lucy, but Zach.
Because obviously having a newly born
it's going to be difficult from a family point of view. And I think with the tight schedule that we run on and the training camps that we go on, it's going to be very difficult.
So, yeah. When he had his clothes on
his belly button, he's got a clip, so we have to be really careful.
No, just all that in my mind. All these ladies coming up their babies.
Right, am I going to row?
If you want to.
Do we know
what we need to do? If you want to know what sort of time is, see if you can speak to Sue, ask her what time they might let me out. She said they've got a side room upstairs, so the kids can all stay with me.
The big event in Steve's life is his baby. After returning from South Africa, the big event in Matthew's life is moving house.
I'm just packing up my house, which is a strangely emotional experience. Spent a lot of time in this house, and seeing it now empty and echoey is really weird.
Tim, do you have anything to say?
Yes.
Oh my God! Can you please introduce this song?
Training is about to intensify for the racing season, which begins in 3 months' time. But after so long at foreign camps, they feel it's time to catch up with their friends and families.
It's Easter today, and I just found an egg. Oh, is that one here?
On camera, there it is. They just kept the hand all the glasses are packed.
What's your house?
Cheers.
Cheers.
Let the bar burn, man. So keep it up, keep it up. There we go. Tim, athlete, sportsman.
Then suddenly, there's a crisis. Something happens to Tim which puts at risk everything the four have achieved so far.
Things are actually great. I've been a bit of a silly boy. Basically at a party we had here in the boathouse, I turned my arm out and put my arm through a window. Old window pane, very brittle unfortunately, and the long and short of it is I leave hospital at 2 o'clock the next day. Having had plastic surgery on my hand, I've managed to either sever or partly cut through four tendons in my right hand.
So we're out without Tim for our first World Cup race, maybe the second, and then we'll have to decide whether he's worth putting back in for the third and fourth. He's performed brilliantly all winter until the last couple of months. His last two ergo tests were particularly great, but you know, our four's been a long way ahead of anyone else. It's a massive blow to us. The question is now, you know, I don't know, my feelings have ways of being sympathetic to him and ways of thinking he's an absolute wanker.
I basically feel pretty stupid. I wouldn't want to row with me if I keep doing things like this. But I don't know what the others feel at the moment. I'd be pretty annoyed with me if I were them.
Well, I feel pissed off with Tim because I think that situation is controllable, isn't it? I mean, I don't think anyone's ever going to turn to any of us and say, you know, don't go out and have a good time. You can turn up at 8 in the morning in black tie having not got any sleep, but as long as the training's done to the right quality, no one minds. I'm frustrated really, because I just don't think I just don't think he's playing by the rules that I am, basically.
Also, I'm pissed off with Tim. I don't think I'm as pissed off as the other two. I don't think he sort of, he obviously hasn't gone planned out to go out and injure himself and not be able to vote for the rest of the season. But we're all individuals and we do things in a slightly different way. And I don't think there's been many complaints of Tim
in the year that we've been round with each other. I think he's been very professional. But obviously it's something that could have been avoided, but you can't wrap yourself in cotton wool.
The Cox is for the number one boat in GP rowing. So that means as well, okay, we have to do everything to keep that boat going.
Another member of the national squad, Luca Gruber, is put in the boat as a substitute. Tim's long-term place could now be threatened.
Yeah, with Tim, for 2 weeks, was absolutely nothing. Nothing happened to his other crew members, so they've been very upset with him because he never gave them any phone calls or any talks, what's happened. So they took all the news from the newspaper or from other people, so they've been quite unhappy with the situation, and especially with how he behaves against or to the crew.
I got sent to Coventry a bit when I turned up, and I don't mind. And I don't really think it's necessarily so much about the accident, it's the bit that it's the fact that I hadn't phoned them or hadn't kept in touch, which is quite odd because I mean my personal way of dealing with it is to sort of, I don't know, get on with my own thing and avoid rowing in a way. And it is quite odd because if I did phone them up, well, I don't really know what I'd say to them.
I'm not there.
Italians in?
I don't think I'd have acted the way they acted, really. I think I'm probably different in that respect. Steve is the only one who made sort of any attempt at chat.
We're a garage knuckle buster, right?
You do feel quite out of the group when you're not there. Although Steve found the same with his diabetes. Yeah, a bit interesting to see, I don't know. Don't know how they get on. Luca's good. Strong, rows well. But I'd hope they wouldn't go as quick as they do with me in it.
Tim's an outsider now, as the others train with Luca, preparing for the first World Cup race of the season.
At the fours now, Luca, Steve, Matthew and me. And if Tim wants to get back in it, he's got to prove himself good enough to get back in it. He's not been given his seat back. None of us have been given it. Steve wasn't given it when... my nipple hair. Steve wasn't given it when he was ill before Christmas. He had to fight his way back in, which he's done, and Tim will have to do the same. So at the moment we're going full ahead with Luca.
And they're away first time, nice and clean, in the final of the men's heavyweight coxless fours.
3 weeks after Tim's accident, the new four races in Munich. Tim watches at home, his future hanging in the balance.
I'm more nervous now than I would be if I was in it.
Now look at this, there's amazing results here turning out at Munich Regatta. It is Romania, they're leading from Germany, and Germany leads the Polish who have rowed through Great Britain. It's been a long time since anyone has rowed through them.
Timothy Foster, who's injured a hand and unable to compete in this regatta, normally gives the crew a lot of length and a lot of balance, and quite clearly they seem to be missing him.
Could this well be the first time that we see the British boat losing, we see Redgrave and Pinsent losing?
I still expect Matthew Pinsent and Steve Redgrave to put in the heroics in the last 250, but they haven't been in this position for years and years.
What we're witnessing here is absolutely amazing pictures here. It is Romania who lead the final of the men's coxless four. Redgrave and Pinsent currently in fourth position. The crowds are standing, the roars are going on, the final will be led and won by Romania, and unbelievable, the British boat come in fourth position.
Oh, it's a sensational result.
We're sitting here now and we really are stuck for words because we knew that they were under pressure, but we thought that the experience of Redgrave...
It's the first time in 8 years that Steve and Matthew have lost a major race.
Great Britain in fourth position.
6.7 seconds.
With the crew in crisis, things can't get much worse. Or can they? Next week, there's a big race at Henley Regatta, but who is in the boat? Tim's hand is on the mend, but his real problems have only just begun.
Maybe the light at the end of the tunnel is getting closer. Can't really get much further away.
This is the story of the struggles and dreams of four men as they strive for Olympic gold. An intimate record from video diaries of their personal lives, loves, ambitions, and fears on the long road to Sydney. Regatta is the social and rowing event of the season. It's fun for the spectators, but for Steve Redgrave's coxless four, it's very tense.
Always, always be mentally tough and strong.
Their East German coach, Jurgen Grobler, prepares them for their first race together for 10 months.
Stay together already as a team, now coming back to our real potential. Again.
They lost their last race. Tim Foster had been out of the boat after putting his hand through a window at a party.
I felt quite a lot of anger towards him. It's been frustrating losing and frustrating that I haven't done anything wrong and I'm in a worse situation because of someone else. You know, it's weird not talking to him for such a long time.
I did very much feel out of it, sort of really sent to Coventry. It's nice to be back in the fold.
It's not as if I feel I've got to go out there and make amends or show them how good I am. I just see it as it's the four's first race. It just means we don't know how fast we are, so I think we'll find out a lot about ourselves.
It's been a tough year for all of them. Steve Redgrave has struggled with diabetes. His team must bond again if he's to get his fifth Olympic gold.
I want to be in Sydney racing for a gold medal. And it's what we do on a day-to-day basis now that determines what our result's going to be.
Winning at Henley would put the four back on course, but it's not going to be easy. Even Matthew Pinsent, normally Mr. Cool, is nervous.
Needless to say, it's a very important race. And, everyone's going to be nervous for it. I've been very nervous all morning. That's an impossible feeling to shake off. It's a good feeling to have, but it's very strange being so nervous at home, being at our home club. It's very different.
The first race is against the Australian Awesome Foursome, the reigning Olympic champions.
Stopping the boats be at the front through trying to
move. It's stiff competition, and after their recent defeat, the four no longer seem invincible.
Same as always, expected and unexpected.
It's a massive test for us, and we're pretty nervous. I'm pretty nervous already, looking forward to it, but in the deep end, put it that way. But that's what we wanted. Go!
This time is about Matthew's hand.
It's a wonderful race. I'm pity Mr. Pinsent is so juvenile.
I get swayed away with your hand and followed from the steward.
From the steward, really? I thought I had a cut and I had to keep it above my head.
Steve's wife, Anne, used to be a professional rower. and is now the team doctor. She comes to as many races as she can with baby Zach and daughters Natalie and Sophie.
Where's your mum? In the back. Can't do it there, eh?
Linford, I'd like to say hello.
How you doing?
All right.
No, not too bad, not too bad. Good. I said I couldn't keep doing that for 6 minutes.
How you doing?
Not too bad.
Unfortunately, just that little bit longer for them.
When they started cloning, I thought, ooh.
That's the first race I've done since. So, yeah. Quite a nice one to get.
Let's get back into it.
Yeah, just over the last couple of days, it's been getting really tight, and I'm thinking, what am I doing to it?
So did it feel all right?
Hand-wise, I said I need something to do with my legs, though. My legs are hurting. I think they're supposed to. For the hand, I couldn't do what Matthew did and take one hand off. I wouldn't trust that. I was working on one and a half hands as it was. So I just put up with a scrawl. Thumb isn't quite bent enough to ride properly.
It's been, a lot more comfortable with Tim in the boat than it was when he wasn't. We've always been at pains to point out that's not a reflection on the guy that we put in his place. It's just the fact that this is the unit that started in the outset, and so this becomes the benchmark. This becomes the comfortable way. This is the way to do it, and then anything else is an alternative.
Thank you very much. How are you?
I'm alright, how
are you? Yes, not so bad.
The final tomorrow is against the Danes, but they all breathe a sigh of relief, having proved to themselves that they are back on winning form.
Yeah, I waited for it, and then the push was good.
You found you could row one-handed?
Yeah.
Well, couldn't row one-handed, that's the case, maybe.
That's where it's our advantage in the middle.
Tomorrow, with both hands.
Just drop it in. And if the boat goes past, the bomb knows
something. The thing is that we can get carried away, that it was a good row and a good piece. But we might have not. Well, I think we haven't raced the fastest four yet.
The next day, they row against the Danes and win again. Congratulations flood in from everyone, including Prince Philip, who knows a thing or two about rowing.
We had ash oars.
Yeah.
The whole oars made of ash. You can imagine, there's more than the row.
Yeah.
And of course, you could never get them straight, so when you pull, they twist it.
Yeah, okay.
The four are champions once more.
Tim's okay. I'm getting on with him just like before, really. I mean, there's a lot to heal any tension that was there when you win. He obviously showed how valuable he was to the four and how well he makes the rest of us row. I just hope the same would happen if I wasn't there. Well, I don't know they'd lose, but I'd hope that I was missed as much. So that's going well. Sharing a room with Tim again for 3 weeks here. Should be okay. Nice and close. Nice double bed for 3 weeks of them.
Over the next 2 months, the four go abroad for a series of races and training camps. As they move from country to country, living and working together 24 hours a day, they have lots of time for bonding, both on and off the water.
Never seen them so aggressive, Martin. Last night around the hotel, they were just quiet, they kept themselves to themselves, and you could see they were really, really pumped. Great Britain are back.
I'm the blue one. You're the blue one, you're the red one. Right.
It is Great Britain, half a length at the moment, in the last 10 strokes, they're up to the line, it is goal for Great Britain.
They win all their races and end the season rock solid, especially Tim and James.
Oh. Wow, what are you
that?
I just pressed it gently just to smell it. But obviously it came out. Hi.
Shave your chest and a little patch up in your left temple.
It's powerful stuff, look. No. This is your best performance ever.
I'd be pleased with that.
See, whereas I'm.
Wait, do you want to come over my leg?
While the four have been away, their home club in Henley, the Leander, has been undergoing a transformation. They're back now to train here for the winter season, in the midst of all the builder's rubble.
I've done the floor layout for the gym and ordered up the equipment. That was my job. But it wasn't my money I was spending.
The refurbishment is costing £3 million, £2 million of which is lottery funding.
The difference with this and other sporting projects is that other sporting projects have to be, you know, made available to the, you know, to the general population. And what was different with this lottery application is that it wasn't going to be like that. It's an elite centre, and that's been a departure for the lottery.
All meetings now take place in a porter cabin. Tim has called the crew together to discuss a health problem. He had a serious back operation in 1995, and a recent scan has shown he needs an injection in the base of his spine.
What they've spotted at the moment is a tear and a sort of small bulge, but nothing sort of major. So as long as I don't stress the disc so it will sort of spread outside, I'll sort of be okay. So it sort of proves there is a problem there that we do need to address. I mean, maybe if it means not rain till Christmas.
I think we have now a little bit of practice in crisis management, especially from the last year. And of course, with his illness now, we have to assess the situation without losing our goal to have him back in the boat as soon as possible, no question.
It doesn't affect me at all, really. I haven't got any problems with it. I'm happy doing what we're doing and training along and giving Tim the time he needs to get back into the boat again.
It was actually nice to see the other guys. It's funny how different they are to me, particularly James, compared to my hand injury, which was self-inflicted. I mean, the hand injury was stupid and but recoverable. I knew it was just a case of getting my hand back into shape, and that wasn't going to affect my rowing with the back, which is caused by my rowing. I mean, that could be something that recurs. It's not a question of 6 weeks out. It could be 6 weeks out, come back, and then out permanently, depending on whether I can, my back can take it. So people say sport's good for you, but it isn't at the top level. There was definite degeneration of the disc. It's just a sign that my body is complaining about what I put it through, really.
You want him to have a nice life after rowing, and you don't want to work at your back now. I mean, people say, you know, would you rather be George Foreman or Muhammad Ali? And you think, well, that's a hard question, isn't it? Would you rather be known as the greatest ever, but have Parkinson's, well, if Parkinson's is caused by his boxing now, or be Foreman, you know, he's got all his senses, he's, you know, happy bloke at 50, no problems, but we'll always be known for losing.
Tim has the injection in his spine and is recuperating at his parents' house.
Had my little operation today, feeling a little bit battered and bruised, but not really worse for wear. Hopefully it's first stage of getting better, so you have to go through this sometimes. I'm at my mum and dad's house that my mum's looking after me, which is nice. Mum's cooking. Hello.
Hello, darling.
While Tim is flat on his back and unable to train, the others have gone to Australia. they intensify their training, becoming super fit. Whilst in Sydney, they go to inspect the Olympic course.
In the future, we're going to be coming into race.
They led by 10 seconds after 500. They were 3 seconds adrift at the halfway mark.
They threw us over.
As long as it's not three of us.
Yeah,
when we come back in 2000. Perhaps there's a new event.
We better get training, mate.
I can hold you.
It's always good to see it before we race. Now you can picture in your mind what you're running towards. It's a shame Tim hasn't been here to see it. He should be back training by January 1st, supposedly. Or maybe not January 1st. I might be feeling a bit rough, but you know, around them.
But things aren't going well for Tim. His back has taken a turn for the worse, and he has to have a disc removed. It's a major operation.
Basically discovered that if I actually stay in bed, it's the only way really to stave off the screaming abdabs, really. Which isn't great in the week when I was hoping to get back into training, get fitter. In terms of what Jurgen will do and someone going the four, will they train? Don't know, it's still early days yet. We don't normally row the four too much at this point. But with only three people, they can either not row it at all or get someone else in, whether that person comes in temporarily or permanently, I don't know. That'll have to be sorted out. It's for Jurgen to deal with, really. He'll talk to the others about it. And hopefully I'll still be a part of it, but everything's up in the air at the moment.
One of the perks of a top sportsman's life is attending balls and society events. Tonight it's the annual Sparks Charity Ball, where celebrities, sports people and royals rub shoulders. Steve is there with his wife Anne.
And you just had another baby, haven't you?
You had yours since I have mine.
Yeah, I've had another one since. No,
mine's 10 months old.
10 months, that's it, I'm in.
James and Matthew's escorts are their girlfriends Emily and Dean.
Who's dressed this week?
That's a cracker, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh.
And the dress is alright.
Unfortunately, Tim has a prior engagement.
Sparks ball. There I am. I'll make a cup of coffee a lot. It's not all bad, I got a free dinner. Free cup of coffee. Don't have to go to the Hilton to have that, you know. It's about 9 o'clock, dinner must be in full swing by then. People have been very nice. The card from James and him and Steve and Matthew. Every once in a while I feel that, I don't know, not that my place is under threat, but I'm threatening the four in some way. I'm not going to be as good as I could be, maybe. The option to give up rowing now isn't something I've contemplated. I mean, I want to carry on, I want to win that gold medal in Sydney more now than I ever have, and basically it means that, I don't know, when I'm standing up there at the top of the roster, I'll know what I've had to go through to get there, and I won't care what other people see or do or what they think. I'll know what I've had to go through to do it, and it'll make it worthwhile. I hope they're having a nice time. You have the Hilton at the ball at the moment? On a bad day, you just wonder if it's worth it. You think it's gone wrong because you're in twice as much pain as you ever were beforehand, before the operation, and you kind of, logically, if you think about it, you know there's going to be an end to it. But kind of when today is worse than yesterday, and it's worse than the day before, if you get a couple on the trot, it's Yeah, it's difficult to think logically.
Tim's recovery is slower than expected. Jurgen has taken Ed Coode out of the eighth boat and put him in the four as Tim's substitute.
What's not anyway decided?
Do we know,
Now 23, he rode for Eton and Oxford, but has only recently taken it up full time.
According to Adam.
Tim,
see
you? Nice to see you. How are you?
Okay, yeah.
Looking good?
Yeah. Feeling quite good. Okay.
Tim comes to the Leander for a meeting to find out when he can come back into the four. Ed Coode is here too.
How we integrate Tim, you know, and then I see it not always straight away four or as a four as a first thing. So okay, maybe coming back in the team.
I must admit, I'm not looking to get back into the team. I'm looking to get back into this crew.
I mean, if I was recovering from an injury, my first aim wouldn't be to get back into the team. It'd be to get back in where I left off. That just if it was me. That's just.
Yeah, but you got to think of how much time he's been off. Done basically any training before Australia.
Limiting factor I look at is my back. I think by the time I'm fit enough to row backwards, I suspect the fitness won't be so much of a problem.
It's going to take time. And obviously we hope that he gets back, but see what happens as it develops. It's important that we keep moving on and not waiting around.
So we just crack on as if, you know, as hard as it sounds, we crack on as if nothing's happened. I mean, it shouldn't make any difference to us.
We will not slow down now and waiting, and so far we have to deal with Ed as well, if we take it personal and not, you know, and face our problem. Okay, it's a hard business, it's a very hard business, my performance sport, no question, you know that, and from other sports.
Of course we want Tim back. We proved last year of how much we missed him when he put his hands to the window, and the fours didn't respond very well until he was back in it, and it certainly gave it a lot more life and convinced to all of us that it's the four of us in that unit, in those positions, that make it as good as it is. Very, very difficult, and it's got somebody else sitting in his seat. That's harder for him to cope with. Yeah, I do feel sorry for him.
Just be a member of the team, which was what Jurgen was saying at the meeting. I mean, it was quite demoralising, really. I've reached a point where I'm now starting to get worried about the getting back in. It's not that I'm not confident I won't be good enough to get in, but I think the worrying thing is how that's done, and I think I did pretty well in all the trials last year. I don't think that much will have changed by the time I'm back rowing. But Jurgen, depends how he sees it.
Steve, Matthew, James and Ed go to a training camp in Seville, while Tim stays in England. This is Ed's big chance to prove himself and advance his career.
I'm the new member of the coxless four for the time being. Jurgen's been supportive and telling me I should be going for it, and that he's not seeing me as just some seat warmer. Tim, I'd like to say, is quite a good friend of mine. It's not nice to see him injured in this way at all. It's given me quite a chance here, though.
It will be annoying when I get replaced, if I get replaced. You know, to do all the hard training with them now and then not racing them in the summer would be pretty painful. Obviously, I prefer staying in the four.
But it's not windy, cold, rainy in Seville.
Tim has started training again. He wanted to go to Seville, but was told he had to stay at home.
The excuse for not going to Seville was so that I could be at home and do normal things.
Yeah, it seems that I'm not at home doing normal things. I'm effectively in a cold, wet, windy Seville.
Tim's been sent to a rehabilitation centre. He's training hard, knowing he's got a tough fight on his hands to get back in the boat. But it's lonely for Tim, training on his own.
It's good to have your dad to talk to, actually, otherwise there'd be no one here. You're my only mate.
English half day nearly.
Yeah. Oh, was that English half day?
Why pass?
Yeah, okay, we're still sitting here and talking.
It's your business.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, fine.
Now the half day. You don't just count the hours on the water, Jurgen. It's the talking about it and the focus that you have as well that's got to be.
Focus right until you stop talking.
Yeah, once you said right, I think session's over. Suddenly you realise how tired you are.
Oh.
Jurgen just said that he thought the boat was going quite well. Says it's given him grey hairs of. Worrying about what he's going to do with it.
And what did you say back?
I said that the boat seemed to be really comfortable. Ed's fitting in quite well.
Yeah.
It just feels to me sort of business as usual, really.
Yeah. Well, I just feel it feels better than that, doesn't it? That's the quandary for all of us, isn't it?
Yeah.
He's just dropped right in and feels as good as it ever has. And if it's this good now.
He adapts quite well to Matthew's and Steve's rowing, but looks quite similar to Tim. We know Tim is a very skillful athlete. He is mentally tough, and his hardness in difficult situation, you know, so to race and so on. That's something we haven't seen so much from Ed Coode, and he has not the chance so far. Yeah, we have to see the difference between those two. Nobody has a free ticket to be in that form. It's only based on performance.
Well, Ed himself a bit. Overrating, we do an extra stroke next time. If James overrating, he has to do a stroke less next time.
This is a tough decision for Jurgen. Ed's obviously flying. Ed's younger, he's got more to improve. He's going to get a lot better by Sydney. But if it'll be good enough to catch up to him, I don't know. But I'm just glad that I have to choose. I wouldn't. We all want the fastest four, and if it's proved to be faster with whoever, then that's the one it goes with. But it'd be nice to have Tim back, really. You know, I do miss Shane, really. I do miss not having him around.
Tim's back is getting better. The doctors have said he can try rowing again.
This is it. It's the first outing of Foster. I'm sneaking up on him. And first time he's taken to the water since October. It's got a nice sunny day for it, Jamie bastard.
Oi.
Very rare outing.
It's quite impressive.
Have to wait months to catch a Foster on the water. This could be the lucky day.
Can't remember what I'm doing.
Oi. It's really nice to see him go out again. You know, I think that's the second time he's had to take 6 months off nearly. He's a strong bastard. Mentally, you know. Hopefully he'll come back to what he was. And then it'll be, you know. Good to get the four going again. Yeah. You know, you do have different thoughts about, you know. Will he come back? When he come back? You know, when he comes back, will he be as good as he was? You know. It's really weird, not that. Really attacking it, which is
Yeah, I guess the thing we're worried about is he wouldn't attack it hard enough, but he has attacked it easily hard enough. I think it's great.
So we started on the water again. So the challenge, I guess, has really started now. After my light introductory period, I have to start proving myself now. Which I'm not doing with the iron very well. I think I must have been pretty spoiled by having three sisters. And a very doting mother. Now, I'm not too worried at all about Tim's return. It was inevitably going to happen. And I'm really pleased with the few months I've done with the four. And who knows, I might even give it a crack to try and take his place. I think if I get a chance to race in it, I have a bit more leverage to keep myself in there.
Tim also realises this. He goes to a meeting at the National Rowing Headquarters to try and get back into the four for that all-important first race in 2 months' time.
All right, to ask the question, I mean, if we're now looking ahead, what's the soonest, the earliest time that Tim, you know, could race, put it plainly?
Okay. As long as he's back to take the trainer, I'd suggest he's got to get up to fitness, and fitness presumably we won't know about until we've seen his BMC test. So we won't know how much he's lost in this period, and therefore how far we've got to go.
It's not easy, David, but
I know.
Okay.
I understand.
Just watching him last week and the week before, I think you can already see it's a progress. I would see him in the second World Cup,
right? Okay.
If that is, I don't know, if that's...
I mean, if you said, to be honest, the first World Cup regatta, it wouldn't be me holding you back. I'd try and see, put it this way. But, I mean, I wouldn't say, it wouldn't frighten me if you did say, if you had the confidence or whatever.
It's from a public point of view, I think we could say, look, it's progressing really well. There's a possibility Tim could be back for early regatta. Doesn't mean he'll be racing in the fall.
In terms of racing the World Championships or the Olympics, it's the four I'm interested in.
Four is our best boat. Jurgen will make sure that we have the best four people in it. Yeah, that's it really. And you've got to get...
Being held back for medical reasons is fair enough, but I feel I'm being held back so they can race the first race of the season and see how it goes, which has made it more worrying.
Tim has every right to be worried. The second World Cup race is only 2 weeks after the first. With only six races all packed into the summer months, there's not much chance for Tim to break into the four, especially if they start winning.
In a way, it's a bit of a slap to have to go through it, because if I can prove through one means I am the athlete I was, then my place isn't in doubt, or shouldn't be in doubt. I mean, I was the one that won all the trials. Every race I was in last year I won. All the seat racing going back to sort of January last year. We did the pairs matrix, and not only did I win it, but I won every individual part of it, which is pretty unusual. I think Ed's a very good oarsman, but I think I'm better.
Ed has now got the leverage he wanted, having been selected for the first World Cup regatta in Belgium.
I'm going to be late. Come on, Carl.
He's got a real chance of staying in the four permanently, and he's going for it.
And it goes up another intensity level in the four. Since they're all a little bit bigger and stronger than me, I don't want to be too defeatist, though. Anyway, can't admit to them that I'm feeling tired, so I'll just collapse here for the afternoon, I think.
Tim is fighting to get fit. He's passing all the fitness tests thrown at him and will compete in the first World Cup regatta in a single scull. It's a hectic time for all of them as they prepare for the race season. The rest of their lives have to fit in around their rowing.
That can be washed, I think.
Pretty well all this stuff can get in the washing part.
Today has been so long.
My preparation tomorrow will be hard sex. Is that the preparation for tomorrow?
The first World Cup race is fast approaching, but Ed needs a break. He's driving to Cornwall to his parents' house.
It's nice to be home, just for the 24 hours that I am. Slightly less than 24 hours. I'm going to have to go back up this afternoon to do a bit more training this evening. I really feel like I've been so intensely involved with the rowing in the past, which I have been. It's been everything since for the past 6 months, especially since Christmas. Really focused on the four. And it's 7 days a week. So just to have this chance to step away from it, see that there are other things in the world beside rowing, there's a strong possibility that Haselwinkel will be my only regatta in the four. And I'd obviously like to do well in it, not be the scapegoat for it going badly.
The first World Cup regatta will decide if Ed stays in the boat. Last year, with another substitute in Tim's seat, the four came fourth. Steve does not want history to repeat itself.
The crunch day, and seeing how we really go in this combination. Since Seville, I don't think it's been as good as the first few weeks in Seville. It went really well, set up really well. I don't know. I think we're not quite sure of how we're going, and we're not as confident about winning.
And here's the new man, Coode. Our first look at him in the World Cup this year.
And a big day for him, not only for today, but for the rest of the season.
There'll be one person sitting in the grandstand at the end of this race, watching this race, and that'll be Tim Foster, looking at the outcome here, wondering how this crew are going to fare after today. But today's race is for them. It's Cracknell, Redgrave, Coode and Pinsent. They know they've got this race wrapped up, just long and loose, enjoying it. Absolutely brilliant. Great Britain won. Easy win in the first regatta. This series.
It was good, I enjoyed the race. It's the biggest amount we've won by. Maybe the competition wasn't that hot, but it's good for Ed. First World Cup win?
It's the first World Cup win. It's about my first win, actually. Put a day off.
How do I pull?
You've got two chances, mate.
Okay.
And the mean, actually. Those glasses, isn't it? You're gorgeous.
Well, it'll be on telly sometime, I hope.
Hi, Dad, how are you?
Yeah.
Well, do you want to know?
Yeah, we won.
Otherwise, I wouldn't be phoning you.
I wouldn't be phoning if I'd lost, did I? No, we won quite comfortably.
Unfortunately, Haselwinkel wasn't such a success for Tim in his single scull. He was knocked out in the first heats.
And I missed out by a second. So that's disappointing. But then, I mean, I've never sculled before at a race like this. But still, when you race, you wanna do well.
Yeah, that does look a comfortable margin, doesn't it? Look, they went the wrong side of the final.
It'd be nice to have been in the four today, because I wouldn't really have had to extend myself. I don't quite know what happens now, so...
I'm not really looking forward to seeing the rest of the team. Just be nice to be sitting down at dinner today. Having got three. And that would have surprised so many people. And I know I could have got three.
But it's really interesting to see what will happen next week. Does Tim come back into the four? He's performing at a reasonable level. Probably faster in a sculling boat than any of the four of us in the four could do at the moment. Really, I don't know. I just don't know the answers. I hope I'm not the one making the decision.
It's the crew's coach, Jurgen, who has the final say.
What is the next step? I think the four, as it is, will race the next World Cup. I think we are the only winner. The four raced well, and there's no point to me to change anything. To make big progress, he is not quite there. From my point of view, he is still on the way up. So he will have a seat in the eight. I discussed that through with Tim. There's no question. Okay, Tim has different thoughts, and this is fine. I think it's no question. His aim is to go back in the four.
The eight is less likely to get an Olympic gold, as everyone is aware, especially Tim.
Don't really see the eight as a long-term option. Not so much because of the people who are in it or anything like that, a negative thing. It's not what I'm here for. It's not what I'm aiming at. It's not what I think my level is, really. But we'll have to see. One of the things James warned me about was that, I mean, the way Jurgen works, it's quite dangerous. If you go in a boat and it goes fast, then you could end up just staying in that boat.
Really relieved to be in the boat for Vienna. And, you know, I guess now I would be upset not to be in the boat, even if Tim replaced me, because I think it's going well. And I think I've been in the crew for a long time now. I'm feeling at home in the boat, you could say.
They are now locked into a hectic training and race schedule. There are two major races coming up, in Vienna and Lucerne, and if Ed continues to be in a winning crew, it's going to be extremely difficult for Tim to break in.
Great Britain will take the second win of the 1999 series. They lead the World Cup in coxless fours. See there, Tim Foster. He'll be vying, though, for his place back in the men's coxless four with Redgrave, Pinsent and Cracknell. A good performance from the British.
Tim also does well in the eights, but this is a double-edged sword.
Well, I like to do it, okay, still to carry on, and, okay, it's not selection now. Leaves the four as a four at the moment for the next 3 weeks.
Maybe, sort of, for the team, it's good, sort of, me rowing in the eight, but it's not something I would do for the World Championships. I mean, I would have to, if there wasn't rowing in the four, then I would then have to think, well, what do I do?
It's all coming to a head. Tim has given Jurgen an ultimatum. It now all hinges on Lucerne. A decision will be made immediately afterwards on who is selected for the World Championships.
That Redgrave has been led this season. It's level, it's stroke by stroke, and who's looking the better? To my mind, the Norwegians close up. Yeah, we've got you. That's what they must be thinking now, and they're just ahead. It's a matter of feet.
They're going to lose this race unless they go now.
Great Britain just inching ahead. It's just on the line, and it is just Great Britain.
I think that race, Gary, was a little too close for comfort for what they would have liked.
A certain individual out in the grandstand, a little smile on his face. Selection date on Tuesday, this coming Tuesday. I should imagine there'll be a huddling of coaches over the next couple of days, starting tonight at the airport. But something has to now change. Something has to think, well, is Tim going to come in?
Tim Foster putting everything in. He knows this race is maybe his ticket to get back in the four.
Britain on 44, 43, 44 strokes a minute. On the line, the Russians, a matter of feet from Great Britain. Very, very good result from Great Britain in a very classy field.
A four win by a small margin, and the eight produces its best performance of the season. It's going to be a tough decision for Jurgen. Back home, Tim is on tenterhooks. He's had a brief chat with Jurgen to arrange a meeting, but Jurgen has given nothing away.
He's obviously pretty pleased about the eight, which either means, yeah, he's pleased with what I've done. He wants me to stay in it. He's pleased with what I've done. Thinks I'm good enough to get back in.
So I don't know. We'll see.
I really know you now for quite a while, especially the last 2 years. You are really growing and shows you are professional in that whole game. Becoming from a medal athlete, really learning to win races. And I think that that's really good. I'm very pleased. How I see it, and at the moment, Tim, I need you in the aid. Tim, I need you in the aid. That's a very, okay, I know that's very disappointing for you, but I see it as a very positive thing from my point of view.
So now I need to make up my mind as to what I do. Do I put my foot down? Or do I concede and do what he wants me to do? And he's practically admitted it's doing this for the team, it's not for me. It's not even necessarily for the four, it's for the team. Am I just not cynical enough? Am I too easygoing? Should I stand up for myself? If he'd have genuinely believed I wouldn't row the 80, he wouldn't have asked me to today, is the impression he wanted to give me. And what would you do?
Okay, how are you, Tim?
Yes, okay. Yeah, I've been thinking and sort of trying to work some things out. But I don't know. Basically, yeah, I'll do the 8 and yeah, be positive. Yeah, and
thank you very much.
It's not all for you. I mean, I want to win in an 8 as well. So.
No, that's the right attitude. So you're coming, please, to the press conference.
Yeah, I'll sort of come down and put on my press face or whatever. So.
Seeing the thing as a whole, the coxless four as the coxless four race through the season is the coxless four for the world championships. And him, he's not been dropped from the coxless four, so okay, he didn't make it so far, but he makes big progress, and I think
this isn't what I've gone through all this for. And the annoying thing is back operation is what's supposed to put paid to your plans, but then it's a personal battle. I've gone better than anything I would have anticipated, and yet still don't get back in for this year, and that's a difficult one to take.
I wasn't by any means certain that I was going to get in. So many people were saying, well done, as if I've got a gold medal in my top pocket already. You know, it's effectively in the bag, which it's definitely not.
There's another year to go, so it's not over yet. Next week, with 5 people for 4 places, Jurgen has to decide who goes to the Olympics. As time runs out, James's love life threatens to rock the boat.
You know, if I don't win the Olympics, I'm going to look back for the rest of my life and regret it.
Story of the struggles and dreams of 4 men as they strive for Olympic gold, an intimate record from video diaries of their personal lives, loves, ambitions and fears on the long road to Sydney.
Yeah.
It's August 1999, and Steve Redgrave's coxless 4 is about to race in the World Championships final held in Canada. It will be the last World Championships before the Olympics in a year's time. But the 4 is missing one of its original crew members, Tim Foster. After a serious back operation, he's fighting fit, but today he's rowing in another boat.
Tim Foster, he's the star man in this 8. He's the man who would have been in the coxless 4, and just look at his face, just impassive.
Today's race will be a big test for Ed Coode. He's replaced Tim Foster for the whole season and has won in every race. He wants to stay in the top Olympic boat, but Tim wants his place back.
And that is an incredible performance. Tim Foster came into the 8 at Lucerne, and who says he's not going to be in the coxless 4 for the Olympics?
The guy's absolutely amazing.
If I'm not put back in the 4 and it's not proved to me why, or it's not proved to me that I'm not as good an athlete as Ed, which if it is proved to me, then I'll find a lot easier to accept them. If I'm not shown that and I'm in an 8, sort of leading an 8 as it were, and if I don't get an Olympic gold medal, I'll feel robbed.
Do you think we've put 3 years of work in to be world champions twice? Whoever's world champions today are going to be world champions for 2 years. There's no way they can beat us.
Lose some control.
Steve Redgrave, cool as you like, look across, now he's calling it, now let's go.
Great brilliant, the hand goes up for Matthew Pinsent as they cross the line, and another gold medal for this absolutely awesome and inspiring coxless 4.
We basically have 5 people for 4 places, and one of us isn't going to go to Olympic Games in the coxless 4.
We've got no idea of when decisions are going to be made, or how it's going to be made, or in what format. So just keep plodding along and waiting to see what happens.
Yeah, I'll have to see what. I have to reclaim my seat, having won the World Championships again. But, you know, not everybody thinks like that. It'd be nice when it's sorted out between Tim and Ed.
Yeah, there's like, that's sort of an aim, so that whatever the top boat is, well, I'm in it. Yeah, I mean,
the chief coach for the British rowing squad is Jurgen Grobler. It will be up to him to decide who rows in the top boat for the Olympics. But selecting the 4 won't be easy.
It's not, I'm not aiming.
No, okay, I'm just.
I mean, that's not my aim. Sort of, yeah.
No, it's okay. I mean, okay, you must not talk too much. Okay, your position is back in the 4. Oh, is that right?
Yeah, I'm in the 4. Yeah, I'm in the 4.
Make it quite simple.
Yeah, the four is what I want to be in.
I consider myself, you know, I have to kick myself and remind myself that hang on, you're in there with them in all rights. You know, I did my job last year and have a perfect right to say I'm part of the British coxless 4, or coxless 5 as it is now.
You know, the other thing is that they're on the rowing on the same side as Steve. And so Steve is going to have to fight to keep his head above water and keep himself out of the selection procedure, because if Steve is the weakest out of those 3, then he won't go. And that would make some headlines.
Steve has been suffering from diabetes and bouts of colitis. He knows the year ahead will be tough, but for now he makes the most of a holiday in Canada with his wife and children.
Alright,
now
big girl's
gloves. Quite a nice place to chill out, really. Got the kids unwind and Anne unwind from the championships.
Alright girls, what's happening up there? All right, well, I've got the video running. I've got all your arguments on tape.
How are you, Ines?
Fine.
Did you enjoy the World Championships?
Yes.
What was the best bit?
Having Having lots of sweets.
Well, what was your best bit, Soph?
When we saw a Canadian man and he gave us a lolly.
Oh. So not too worried about Dad winning his race, just about who gave you a lolly.
I am pleased that you win your race.
Uh-huh. Good.
The year is drawing to a close, and Jurgen is no closer to making his choice. It looks like they'll have to wait until the new millennium.
Here we are, on the way to Waterloo.
Waterloo.
Let's bring the new year in. Bring in.
Slow down a bit.
This is. This is Mrs. Grumpbutter.
I'm not.
Here.
Tim's been in really such a bad mood all evening. You can tell. Look at him.
Yes, I'm in a really bad mood. This one here, I think it must be, it's not only the change of the millennium, it must be that time of the month.
Is that hurting?
Is it really?
No!
Don't worry, I understand. I'm a man of the 90s. In fact, I'll soon be a man of the noughties.
Happy New Year.
Hello!
And Biggles!
Bloody hell!
Biggles has arrived.
Biggles, say hello to the camera.
Where's the camera?
We're on camera here.
We're on camera here. We're going to play champagne.
There we go.
Good. There's Biggles.
Why don't you get some Jerry on the way, I'll be pleased to know.
Oh, I'm very proud!
I hope it's going to be a successful year, and I hope it's going to bring good tidings, especially in February. And,
what's going on in February?
Selection.
Selection.
He means Valentine's Day, I think.
Lean
forward and pull back. That's how you do it.
It's time for me to go to bed. As I'm quite drunk now and I have a feeling I should be very hungover when I wake up. It's now 10:45 on New Year's Day and I'm very hungover indeed.
Coxless 4 is the number one boat. I think the Coxless 4 as a whole, how I see things at the moment, it's not for discussion, and I have confidence in everybody. What I like to do, to make the decision as early as possible, for the 4, I really like to have it done latest before we go to Seville.
What is there in between sort of now and then that is... is going to affect the decision? It's sort of a bit of obvious question.
What are you going to know then that you don't know now?
Okay, I mean, we're just starting to make progress and do some testing as well.
It's going to come down to your instinct. It's not going to be Ed beating Tim at the sculling trials, therefore, you know, or ooh. Tim's beating, you know, Ed on the ergo. It's not, there isn't going to be one thing, is there? Mm.
You can trust me.
So what? A meeting like that really doesn't change my strategy towards rowing. Okay, perhaps if Jurgen had said, yes, definitely, it'll be this ergo test that counts, I would aim to peak very highly for that, and it would affect my training on other days around it. But Jurgen hasn't said that, and Jurgen was never going to say that. And the only strategy you can really have in rowing, or for a selection like this, is to, you know, concentrate on the here and now and the job at hand, all the cliches, do the best you can on for each particular day.
It's January, and Jurgen has put the crew into pairs for training. Steve and Matthew are one pair, James and Tim another.
I can't see why he would put me in a pair with James if he didn't sort of think that was relevant for the 4.
Ed hasn't been left on the shelf. He's been paired with one of the Searle brothers, Greg, who won an Olympic gold medal in 1992. For Jurgen, this could be the chance to develop a new pair for the Olympics. Steve is throwing a 40th birthday party for his wife, and the theme is 70s.
Wow!
The only medallion I could find is my nephew's swimming award from last week. He's lent it to me for the evening, but I'm sure I can pull in this outfit.
Oh, you're stunning!
Oh, Mark, decidedly conservative.
I reckon we have to get the Olympic. How many have we got of you? Four? Five?
Five.
On the stage for a picture, please. Any pictures left?
A rough date of where you hope the decision will be made. Like you had done before, you said you'd hope to do it by Christmas, and then you said you'd hope to do it by Seville. Is it now by the end of Seville, or is it going to be April trials? Or
you can already see how difficult.
Oh no, but
you know, and so far, of course, put out those dates. You can see how complicated sometimes it is if we nail ourselves on absolutely dates.
You said you'd like to make a decision.
Yeah, I'd like to, and so far...
we always knew that you'd like to make a decision by Seville, and it was obvious to us that it wasn't going to be before Seville. So you've got to have in your mind when you would
mind. Of course, because it affects everybody, who would like to do it as early as possible, no question, but at the same time. If we're working one for all for one, you know, we'll develop, even the person is not in the boat, give them really good support for the next step. More questions, Matthew?
Plenty, Jurgen, but I don't think any more answers.
Do you mean any more answers?
Okay, then.
It's disappointed us a bit in that we thought the decision would be made before Seville. I mean, that's what he said when we had the meeting in Sierra Nevada before Christmas. He's now sort of putting eggs on that, and he's saying the decision will be made later. I mean, it's quite worrying because, well, I think I'll get in. Or I thought I'd get in.
I know for a fact that Tim thinks he's hiding or that he's shying away from the selection issues. And I can see why he would. It's very difficult for him to say categorically when the crew will be decided. You know, what is the deciding matter that's going to make the difference between Tim and Ed, or even Steve, Tim and Ed. I mean, that's another can of worms that we may have to negotiate.
Disappointed that it's just gone on another few weeks that we thought maybe it wouldn't, doesn't need to. But if he knows now, he should tell us and then we can sort it out. But, you know, just have to keep plugging away. We've got our own targets that we've got to achieve, so...
What are the strengths in my performance or James's performance that are going to mean that we maintain our position in the crew? And as crew coach, I think it's very important that Jurgen at least answers those questions honestly, even if it's to say, I don't know.
Your film.
What? The crew is off to Seville for training and racing. It's one of the many trips abroad which can create problems at home.
What? Words like those. Me and Emma having a lot of arguments at the moment. Over nothing, really. Probably because we're both a bit tense. She's still a lot of college work. She's obviously doing it in a second language isn't easy, and I'm probably pretty crap at understanding and stuff like that. Impatient, I guess. I'm always thinking about myself. So... Yeah, but it seems to be it's okay at the moment, but yeah, the last few days, but a few days we don't talk to each other much and it's just a bit, you know. So added stress neither of us needs, so hopefully we can sort of work it out between us.
How can you look, see the difference on them?
Because some of them, because I know them, I spend my life in them, I can tell the difference, and some trap my bollocks in an uncomfortable way.
In Seville, Jurgen has planned a series of races among the crew. They are to take turns in the four to see which combination is fastest.
We had a meeting last night about these races and Jurgen was very keen to point out that it wasn't selection and no one should lose any sleep over it but try as he might, I think there are obviously, you know, people who are worried about this. I think Steve and I are in a different situation in that during these races we don't move out of the four, and so it's obviously not us that's being tested directly against other people. It's much more James versus Greg, but primarily I think it's Tim versus Ed as well. Done the first piece. Can't quite see at the moment how I'm going to be able to do four of those, but I thought it was a good start. This is now halfway between the pieces, and we lose Tim and James.
No, you gain.
And we gain Eddie Boy and Greg, who's just this moment finished performing a bodily function.
Cracking over the side.
Only because I was nervous.
Just done the third piece out of four. And I'm now sitting down. Not looking forward to this last one. And then that'll be it. Then we'll have done almost every combination of the four that we can do, and the pair will have seen every combination of the pair.
No idea! We're upon the lead!
If I was chief coach now, I'd sit down with Ed and say, you know, you did everything right as far as the trials goes, but essentially, you know, I think the four goes quicker with Tim than it does with you. Can't believe that Ed's going to be happy. Totally happy about it, but
there's always going to be whoever wasn't in the four.
was not going to be happy.
I just had a chat with Jurgen, and yeah, he was kind of keen to point out that I was still the strongest, and still a world champion, and mustn't worry about the selection he's made for this weekend and things like that. But in a way, that's a bad thing. In a way, you know, I can't concentrate solely on getting the pair right because I still have that idea of being in the four in the back of my mind.
An international regatta gives Jurgen the chance to check out Tim in the four. After the race, spirits are high. There's mischief in the air, and it involves a statue from the hotel lobby and one of our video diary cameras.
Friday night.
Then we found a visitor in our toilet, and now we want to find out how he got there.
And the evidence is on this camera.
They're all nervous, they are.
They're nervous.
It's a pad. It's a piss.
They didn't leave us any kind of sarky message.
From all of us.
Steve is 38 today, but it's a special day for all the crew. They're about to take an ergonomic test to measure individual speed and stamina. With selection still in doubt, the pressure is on to get a good result.
What a good day's breakfast, haven't we?
I don't think there's much point getting too nervous for these. You kind of get what you get, really. You've got to be brave and be brave. When you've got to, I think it pays to be brave and attack them.
Jeff is about to do a circle test, and I have given you no sleep as you picked me up very, very late last night.
Well, looking forward to it, not at all.
So, if he doesn't do a good circle test, it's my fault.
Yeah, I blame it all on you.
Okay, good luck.
I'll see you later.
Yeah.
Sometime.
I really want to do well today. But I also know that doing well is going to hurt a lot.
Not looking forward to the pain aspect of it. It'll hurt. Be pretty uncomfortable. Yeah, that's quite scary.
The whole situation, it's important that I just do a good test and make sure that I'm ahead of the others.
During the ergo test, each rower will push himself to the absolute limit. The race is on to produce their fastest time over 2,000 metres on rowing machines. Competition is keen among the crew, and for Jurgen, the tests are critical.
Yeah.
and relax. His performance has satisfied Jurgen. Now the spotlight is on Ed. Ed had started too fast and now can't keep up the pace. He fails to complete the test. But the competition for places in the four is still on. Matthew is about to break the British record and James achieve his personal best, but Steve is struggling to keep up. Having set out to beat the others, Steve's test goes badly wrong. It's clear to everyone that his performance might be affected, not only by his diabetes, but also by his age.
I appreciate birthday. Ergo test didn't go very well at all. Pretty pissed off about it. Not just getting the power transferred from my legs. Legs feeling very tired. I've been feeling pretty tired all week really. I came very close to passing out completely, which normally in ergo tests you're under a lot of stress and pain, and you go through the pain barrier, and that can be pretty painful afterwards. But to be in the situation of nearly passing out shows me that there's something not quite right.
Steve and Ed were able to redo their ergo tests, and both results were up to Jurgen's standards. Time is running out for Jurgen. He has to announce his decision in 2 days' time, after the national pairs trial in Nottingham. The whole squad will be taking part, racing against pairs from all over Britain.
We're all in opposition against each other. You know, I want to beat Steve and Matthew tomorrow, just as much as I wanted to beat Norwegians or the Australians last summer.
I've been waiting for tomorrow for a while. It's a chance to prove ourselves. It's a chance to get things sorted out.
Steve and Matthew were in our semi-final and were shocking. Okay, final's still to come. You can't write them off, but they were a long way down. A long, long way down. Which is worrying.
Basically, we need to pull the rabbit out of the hat. If we're going to win, we need to pull a very sizable rabbit out of a very small hat. I think the odds of doing that are pretty slim, actually, I have to say now. Not a position that we're used to being in.
I think we just need to
dig deep in our big hat.
Well,
see if we can find the rabbit.
Row for one thing, not fucking scramble up and down like two muppets.
Jurgen will be watching the pair's race from his car. His top rowers must prove their ability ahead of the pack.
Quick back, go on the start, please. Hey. Closing up a bit.
That's good eyes.
Yeah.
Good eyes. I would like to see. Close and fight. That's the people we need. Good. Good.
Tim and James take first place, Ed and Greg second, and Steve and Matthew third.
For the group, first, second, third. Good.
Would have been nicer to have been up near the front of the race, but...
Of course, if this was America, if somebody's pointed out, you'd be out of the team, wouldn't you?
I mean, you know, everyone looks at the American system and thinks that's ridiculous.
Feel a bit for Steve and Matt in one way that, you know, they've won pairs to us every time, but the day there were loads of press here, they lost. On the other hand, I don't feel that sorry for them because, you know, me and Tim, you know, you could have said that they rushed their training for a bit, didn't maybe put the same amount of attention on it, which I guess there wasn't the same amount of pressure on them as there was on, definitely on Tim, I guess, to win his battle with Ed, so it's understandable in a way, but, you know, they can't expect to win if they don't put absolutely everything in.
We're reigning Olympic champions. That's not a good performance at all. And we can kill ourselves about it if we want to, but it's not. It's not good enough. For whatever reason, for us not going well as a unit, I don't know.
It's the big day. With a press conference later in the morning, Jurgen has called the boys in early to announce his selection. At last.
Morning.
But yeah, basically been called in. I know James has, I know Steve has been called in at 7:30 to come out at 7:30 this morning. For a meeting with Jurgen. So I think today is the decision day.
Expect we'll find out this morning for our first training session before the press conference is at 10 o'clock this morning.
Well, shoot. That's the thought of the press conference. We've been called down early to training. Very stressed out geezer over there. Oh. You see that? 7:30 in the morning, and Jurgen on his mobile phone.
First, I would say I don't like to make a drama or whatever, and you know me, I'm not the guy making a lot of words or big words. Well, I'd like to say first, well done for your performance, all of you so far, and especially I think the pairs finals, so I'm very pleased. I must say as well, of course, it was a strong test for all of you through the autumn and through the winter, and I must say a really big respect how you handled that big pressure. So for the coxless four, I think on stroke side, with all the testing we have done, I think Messi really moved on to a big performance. So I think there's no question mark to me to carry on, see the same position to James
on Bauer's side, first, Steve, I think he has demonstrated to me his performance. He's been, in the last 3 years, a key player in that coxless four. And, of course, sometimes you're getting older as well. You have to pace yourself well, and I think that's what we try to do. And I think, from my point of view, I see no problem there not to have him in the boat. Of course, we know what we have with Tim when he came in and his improvement. I think my position is to have Tim back in his seat. And that's from my point of view as a four. I must say, in front of everybody, maybe then somebody would like to say something, that you should go not from here and feel as a loser. And I'm sure all those guys sitting here will back you. It's a big, big respect to you.
You know, I haven't got any great, believe me, I haven't got any great problem with that, any great bitterness against it or to get upset about it. I'm quite looking forward to doing the pair now. And, I just also, like I said, I'm kind of fully supportive behind the four there. Anything happens, what about like?
From now until the Olympics, the four are under increasing pressure from the press. Even fitting the official Olympic suits becomes a photo opportunity.
You know what you are? You are a sex bomb, sex bomb. You're a sex bomb. You can give it to me when I need to come along. Give me sex bomb, sex bomb. You're my sex bomb. And baby, you can turn me on. Oh, baby. Sex bomb, sex bomb. You're a sex bomb. And you can give it to me when I need to be turned on. No. Sex bomb, sex bomb. Well, you're my sex bomb. And baby, you can turn me on. Turn me on. And baby, you can turn me on. Turn me on. Baby, you can turn me on.
I'm not going to say that the past 8 months training has been a complete waste because I haven't got into a four. I'm going to go to the Olympics in a pair. And that's, you know, exciting for me. That's very exciting for me. Certainly hope the other three people in the four, or the other, including Tim actually, all four of them, Steve and Matthew and James and Tim, aren't sitting at home talking to their cameras going, oh God, poor Ed, you know, he's in a disastrous position now. I don't think they are.
Tim and Beth have come round, and Luca and Emma here, and we're having a sort of, you know, post-trial celebration.
Now they know who's in the boat, the four are preparing for the forthcoming World Cup races. But concern is growing for James. He's rapidly losing the weight he's gained over the last 4 years. His relationship with Emily has taken a turn for the worse.
At the moment, Em's moved out, so I have moved out. To the kitchen. So actually I'm on my own, which is pretty hard to take, I have to say. I don't know how much of it is me missing Em or how much is me being sad at being alone. I just did a lot of thinking. It's the first time really that in 4 years the Olympics hasn't been a priority, I'm still losing weight. In a way it's bad, but I blame running for what's happened because of the way it consumes my life in terms of emotionally. It really does. you know, I give it everything, and I just haven't given the relationship everything, and that's driven them away. It's very hard. Very hard to wake up in the bed when you're there and just come home. You know, normally we'd watch it together, I'd relax off the training, whereas now, if I'm going out, I'm not focused on rowing, and I'm, you know, because I'm just not looking after myself at all, which is really shit, which is something I've been really good at. I'm married to three other people.
Everyone knows what's been going on with me, and I haven't really, I've been coming down, but probably going through the motions and not really thinking about the rowing, and I've got to decide what's important, what I want to do, and you know, as if I, in 2 years' time, I could look back and regret being with Em, regret losing Em, but you know, if I don't win the Olympics, I'm going to look back for the rest of my life and regret it. And the last 2 weeks have been pretty hard, and you know, I had a good chat with Jurgen yesterday, and you know, I've just got to be, go back to being myself, and if that means we're not going to get back together, it's not important. But I feel that the four of you are the things that matter the most to me.
I don't think you have to feel in the position that you're letting us down, because I don't think, even as bad as you think it may have been in the last few weeks, I certainly wouldn't have said that it's been affected. Obviously, you know, you need to be on a, you know, stable situation at home to make sure that you row your best, and if you feel you're not rowing your best, then, you know, that's one thing. But I think on a personal basis, none of us should box ourselves into the corner and think that rowing has to deprive our lives of other things to the extent that, you know, we can't have relationships or whatever. You know, it's not as easy as saying, right, well, winning an Olympics is more important to me at the moment than anything else, or they are different things, and you can have both.
It can have both, but I can't just think about one all the time, which is what I'm doing, and that's...
Okay.
So you want us to move in?
Doesn't affect the rest of us. But he's turning up for training sessions on time, he's doing all he's asked to do. But I think he sits around his house quite a lot and thinking about things and moping about things, and as Jane as a character, he's either very, very high or very, very low. It's one extreme or the other. That's the type of character he is, and at the moment he's extremely low. I know the feelings, I've been there myself. But life goes on.
Weeks later, the international racing season has begun in Munich. James is determined to prove he's back on form.
Hammers now. British boat up to the line. It's looking though it could be Great Britain. It's Steve, ever the world champion, ever the experienced man, just pulls them in. So, gold medal to the men's coxless four.
In the feeling of crossing the line and waiting for the rest of the world to finish, and then standing up there on the podium, or the national anthem, or the Union Jack sort of going up, and you know that's you. It's something that no one can ever take away from.
And they'll win with three-quarter again, three-quarters of a length, but the margin is not great.
They're having to work harder each race, but let's not forget it, they are still crossing the line in first, so they are still the class crew, and they are still the crew favourites for gold at Sydney.
Redgrave's four.
We haven't lost yet.
We haven't lost with Tim in the boat, we haven't lost Bird in the boat, and it's important we keep that run going. As soon as that we don't show the form that we should do, then the media will be getting onto our backs. And that's an added pressure that that we don't need. It's hard enough to win anyway.
Zurich Rowing World Cup was set alight yesterday with the shock defeat of the Great Britain coxless 4 in the semi-final by the New Zealanders. Well, that was yesterday, and today is a different day, and today is a day for revenge. There's only one prize here today for all the other five crews, and that is the scalp of Stephen Redgrave. Great Britain at the moment are well and truly defeated. And this is just amazing. What can we say? And the British just got into fourth place.
It's not quite how I wanted it to finish. The cuckoo clock going by the side of it. But if anybody had been watching the last three programs, the story's not over yet. We've got the next 2 months to get back on track, get out to Sydney, and we're going to win that gold medal.
All four of us, we all underperformed, and we've all got another chance to prove it, that we are by far the best four in the world, and luckily that chance is the Olympics 2 months away. I'm not saying this after the Olympics, so we've got to wait 4 years to prove it again. We can prove it again in 2 months' time. And we know we'll be ready then. And we know we weren't particularly ready now, but we'll be definitely be ready in 2 months. So I'm well up for it. Mad for it.
See you in Sydney.
The crew is now in final training in Australia. Their big race is on September the 23rd.